The revolution will be live.
On Monday, President Trump threw America under the bus as he stood side by side with Vladimir Putin. Yesterday, he tried to explain why he did that.
I accept our intelligence community's conclusion that Russia's meddling in the 2016 election took place. Could be other people also. There's a lot of people out there.
Now, a few hours before that statement, Anthony Scaramucci, former comms director, told us that the president should reverse course immediately and issue a statement. Former White House communications director Anthony Scaramucci is back with us now to tell us if he is satisfied with that statement. Thank you for coming back, Anthony.
Who writes the copy, though, where he threw the people under the bus?
You didn't think he threw America under the bus?
No, I don't think he threw America under the bus.
You don't think he blamed America first in Helsinki?
I think he made a mistake. I think he misspoke. I think he went to the cabinet room yesterday, told the American people
hold
that he misspoke.
Hold on, Anthony. When he said, I blame America, let me read to you. In fact, we have it. Let's just play what the president said in Helsinki. So we're all on the same page of what he said about America.
Okay.
Let's play it. Let's play it.
I hold both countries responsible. I think that the United States has been foolish. I think we've all been foolish. We should have had this dialogue a long time ago. A long time, frankly, before I got to office. And I think we're all to blame. I do feel that we have both made some mistakes.
The United States has been foolish. We've all been foolish. We're all to blame.
Yeah.
You think that was representing America well?
Yeah, well, we have to now apply context to that. What he's basically saying over the last three presidencies, the tension and the anxiety as it relates to our relationship with Russia has gone up immeasurably.
This was about interference in the 2016 election. You think we're to blame for that? You think we're to blame
interference? Now you're taking it out of context.
No, that's what the question was.
Okay, Allison, I'm trying to explain what the guy did. I understand what the question was, but I also understand the president pretty well. I understand what he was trying to say, and so I'm just going to explain it to you. He basically was saying there that the tension has been risen, and there should have been more dialogue on both sides. And I think what he was trying to do is make a conciliatory gesture there by saying, look, I'm not going to be blaming one side. We know whether it's a marriage, we know whether it's a relationship, a diplomatic relationship, that it's never 100-0. And I think that's all the president was trying to say.
Well, the way you're framing it now, Anthony, is different than how you said it yesterday. But furthermore, why would that? Why would the way you're framing it now have upset so many Republicans so many Americans?
So I don't
Clearly, he said something that felt as though it was
that upset everybody. I can tell you what upset me. And I can tell you, you know, again, I'm very loyal to the president, but I also want to be very honest because I want to help the president. Okay, I'm a patriotic American. I love the president. I probably said that too many times from the press box when I was the one-day press conference.
Yeah,
but I do really like him, and I want to see him do very well. What I was upset about, and I think what most Americans would be upset about if they analyzed it, is knocking the national intelligence agencies.
Right.
That's what I'm upset about. Right.
And so
not what he said about there's problems on both sides of the relationship.
Okay. So you have your own beef about what he said. Do you think that that one grammatical fix, he meant wouldn't instead of would. Do you think that changes his message?
I was watching Maggie Haberman in the green room, and I think Maggie Haberman's instincts are right on this. This was a lot like the Access Hollywood situation. I was present for the Access Hollywood situation. And I've seen the president now apologize twice. I've known him for 20 years.
Okay.
He apologized to his wife and the American people, the Access Hollywood situation. He apologized to Theresa May last week. And he just walked this thing back.
Hold on a second. I just want to make a point right there. You've known him for 20 years. And in those 20 years, you've seen Donald Trump apologize twice.
Yeah.
This is a man who is reluctant to ever admit wrongdoing.
Okay, because that's been part of a strategy in his life that has made him very, very successful. Okay, maybe it came from Roy Cohn, maybe it came from his dad. I don't know where it came from. You'd have to interview him and ask him where it came from. But his strategy has been to always operate off the ball of his foot, not operate off his heels, and not to be a guy that apologizes. And so, listen, I took the Dale Carnegie course when I was at law school.
How to win people over?
Yeah, and the first thing they told you was that if you're doing something wrong, apologize, okay? So I'm an easy person to get an apology from. The president is not an easy person to get an apology from.
So then what happened yesterday?
That's his nature.
The fact that he walked it back
yesterday, it's also been unbelievably successful in his life. Just look at his life.
okay, yeah, he's president, so obviously he did something, right? Mm-hmm. So what happened yesterday then? Since this is somebody who is so resistant to ever admitting wrongdoing, what changed in the White House?
So I think that his super loyal people, okay, the people that are super loyal, you know, it's one thing, if you're telling me, you're working for me, and you're telling me I'm tall and right, well, I know we're going to have a problem, right? Because I want to be told that I'm short and wrong. You understand that?
I do
because
understand.
Because once you're telling me the truth, then I know I can work with you, okay? And so I don't know who it was, but there's probably a cadre of guys, men and women around the president, where they said, what do you think? And he said, look, I got to be honest with you. You got to walk this thing back because you love the rank and file people in these intelligence agencies. You're upset with a few people at the tippy top that politicize these agencies, but you really do love the rank and file people. And we're spending billions of dollars. And Allison, we're losing lives all over the world to gather this intelligence.
That's what you wanted him to say yesterday, Anthony. Your statement yesterday on New Day of what you prescribed for him to say was so much stronger and went so much farther than what he did say. You wanted him to say that they sacrificed their lives. You wanted him to say to really show heart in supporting the intelligence agencies. And he said he meant to say wouldn't, but he said would. That satisfies you?
So from a symbolic perspective, it does satisfy me because I think what the president is basically messaging to people is that he got the thing wrong. He's a reluctant guy to walk things back. He walked it back.
But hold on.
Let's
just
move
one
on.
Second.
Let's move
he
on.
He got his grammar wrong or he got his mindset wrong?
Well, I said yesterday that this was not an issue related to words. This was an issue related to strategy and this was an issue related to broad-based policy, okay?
Yeah.
And so he went in a direction to go from would to wouldn't, and that is a step in the right direction.
But do you
really
believe that was the problem?
No, I, and again, I've said this. I'm a pretty open person. I said that I would have said it differently, but I'm not him, and I'm not the American president. And so
I understand, but I don't think the problem was the grammar, do you?
I don't think the problem was the grammar, but I do think that we have a escalated situation with the Russian government that he is trying to de-escalate. And I think we have to give him credit for that. We have an escalated situation with the North Korean government that's lasted almost three decades. He's trying to de-escalate that. We have to give him credit for that. You know, we may not like the messaging. You know, there's an expression in basketball, sometimes people are playing the man when they need to play the ball, okay? And so we may not like his messaging, we may not like the coarseness of his rhetoric, this guy's got amazing political instincts. He knows we have to right-side the trade situation. He knows that we have to right-size and fix the international community as it relates to our alliances. We have to strengthen them.
But he doesn't seem to believe his intel agencies over Vladimir Putin. That's the bottom line.
No, I think he does.
What makes you think that?
Well, he said as much from the cabinet room. I think he was probably reluctant.
He was sticking to his script. You saw him reading their script, which was so different than when he was riffing in Helsinki. Which one was the real Trump?
Well, they're both the real Trump. That's why your ratings are up. Okay, he's a fascinating guy. Okay, both of those things are the real Trump.
But how can you believe Vladimir Putin? Let me ask you the question. How can you believe Vladimir Putin when he is so
strong? You're going into Chris
Cuomo
territory, just so you know.
And so powerful in his denial. That's what the president said.
Yeah.
And believe your intelligence communities. They're diametrically opposed.
Yes. If you go to some of the rhetoric President Obama said in December of 2016, it was sort of similar.
I'm talking about President Trump.
The president of the United States, whether it's President Obama or President Trump, they are on a tightrope. And they are negotiating and threading a needle between trying to figure out a way to get along well enough with Vladimir Putin so that we can de-escalate it and also address the fact that they're meddling in our elections and we have to figure out a way to curb the elections. The White House put out a whole list of things that the president has done in the last 18 months to strengthen our ability to block people, whether it's Russia or other people, from meddling in our elections.
Let me ask you this, Anthony. How do you recommend to Democrats or Republicans or just human beings mm-hmm. who are having a hard time unhearing what they heard the president say in Helsinki, who are having a hard time unhearing the president blaming America, how are they supposed to move on and believe that the president feels differently?
What I would say to everybody is that we probably on both sides, frankly, we have to dial back the rhetoric. We have to dial back the polemics. I think when someone's saying that the president's treasonous, I disagree with that. When they're comparing this to Kristallnacht, if you really understand what happened in November of 1938.
Of course, we've dialed all that back. But in terms, but you're saying that we just have to understand that the president will say things on different sides of the issue.
I'm saying that, and I'm actually praying for this, that the White House, the president has phenomenal political instincts. He's got very good judgment on a lot of these issues. If they can marry very good communication and they can marry a better delivery mechanism of what he's trying to do and explain it better to
the American
people.
What does that mean? Stick to the script? Stick to the prompter? What's that delivery mechanism?
What that means is that, you know, like, as example, I don't want to be a Monday morning quarterback, but as an example, in Helsinki, if the president said, listen, we have a little bit of a disagreement here on the meddling situation. It's not collusion, but we're talking about Russian meddling. Our intelligence agency believe they did. It didn't happen on my watch. I've explained to the Russian president that we can't have this happen in 2018 or 2020. And if it does happen, we're going to have to be very strict in terms of the sanctions
Anthony,
that we apply.
Do you know how different that is than what he said? If he had said that, people would have been comforted. He didn't say a shadow of that.
I understand that, but let's get there. We can get there.
Okay. How? Who do you trust in the White House to get him to that point?
You put me on the spot yesterday. Look, I got a lot of friends in the White House, but I've obviously got some people in the White House that don't like me, so I don't want to mention names and then the people that don't like this people. Here's what's going on in the White House that I don't like. Everybody's siloed in. Everybody's afraid of each other. And then the people that don't like each other, they run outside the White House and they grab their cell phones and they leak bad information on the people that they don't like to the outside world. So, you know, I've got adversaries inside the White House. Washington is very different from New York, okay? In New York, we're about collaboration.
I get it.
Washington's
a zero-sum
game.
Here's my question, my last question.
So I'm not going to tell you who I like and dislike in the White House. I like the president.
Is there anybody?
I like Melania, too. I think she's great.
Great. Is there anybody in the White House who can do what you're suggesting, which is tell the president when he's wrong, and who is that person?
Yes. There's members of the cabinet, and there's members of the White House. And so, you know, you're putting me on the spot, Allison, in a way that I don't want to answer the question.
I see that.
Why am I going to make the? Why are we going to put their people?
Because it's a compliment. You'd be complimenting somebody that they are powerful enough to tell the president.
I love complimenting people, but I know the adversarial nature of this thing. Okay, I bore witness to it, and you know, in my 954,000 seconds,
no,
it was only 954,000 seconds. I got taken out for being a little bit too honest, right?
Okay. So you've learned your lesson.
So let's,
there you go.
Well, you know, for the first time in my life, I'm going to hold my tongue. How about that?
All right. It's inconvenient for me, but it may work for you. Anthony Scaramucci.
It's the right thing to do.
Thank you for coming on. We appreciate
being
seeing
here.
You. John. All right. The revolution will be live.